We're wrapping up our series of our on-ramping series of messages. We have two more messages left, and I understand Pastor Tanisha just preached an amazing message last week that, amen, I'm just so thankful, amen, that we have great orators and preachers of the gospel that can lay this thing out for us and help us all to keep growing in our faith. Amen. And so I'm going to try to continue with a couple more messages on ramping, but really focusing and continuing to expand on the power and the role of the Holy Spirit in our lives, and really, really invite all of us to imagine what does it look like for us to lean in even the more around the role of God's Spirit in our lives. Now, next week, we're going to, as I preach, I'm going to be preaching from a topic called blind spots, and talking about how the Holy Spirit is able to open up all these parts of our lives that may be blind spots for us. And we're going to have a special emphasis around mental health next Sunday, because this is a mental health awareness month, the whole month of May, I understand. So we're going to have a special panel during our service as a part of a special emphasis, where we're going to bring in a couple of therapists and Christian-based therapists, folks who are walking with God, but also can give us a few minutes of reflection about how to take good care of our mental well-being. And I have a desire here at The Way to have a real vibrant mental health support ministry. And so I'm so glad that Sister Jeannie, I saw her, wave your hand wherever you are, Sister Jeannie, amen. And Sister Jaslyn, amen. Few others, amen, are going to be helping out with this part of our ministry. So we'll get a chance to hear a little bit from them. So let's make every effort again to get as plugged in as we can. How many of you have started your live groups or ministry groups? Anybody? Anybody since we've been gone? A few of you guys? Amen. Thank God for four or five of y'all. Amen. All right, so we'll do a little bit more emphasis on that as well. Let's turn to the book of Acts, chapter number 2. Acts chapter number 2 is where we will spend our time this morning. Acts chapter number 2, we know that the book of Acts is, in many respects, what we understand to be Luke part 2. And it is written by the same author who wrote the book of Luke, really making every effort, I believe, to help us understand and appreciate the role and the function and even the power of the church, the gathered, those who are here intentionally seeking and chasing after God and God's purposes in the world. Acts chapter 2, then we find a very important and powerful expression and narrative and even history of the birthing of the first church, which I think is going to be very important for us as we have these last few sermons and conversations about how do we then on-ramp into God's church and the ministry of God in the world. Acts chapter 2, when you have it, somebody say, I got it. All right. Hopefully it's on the screen as well, and we'll be able to follow through. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. Everybody say one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation. Everybody say every nation. Every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And I must just pause and say that it is so important, as I was there, to appreciate that for all the narratives of how Jerusalem, certainly throughout the years, very contested place in space. It was fascinating to see while I was there that Palestinian Jews and Christians living in harmony and peace, and Muslims for that matter, living in harmony and peace for many, many centuries. There, amen, was not nearly the amount of violence and conflict as you would think if you believed everything you read on the news. And listen to every bad report you heard coming out of the Middle East. So it's really fascinating that even during this time, there were Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. Hopefully we can get and aspire to that place where there can be people from every group worshiping and spending time here at the Way. Amen. But we'll keep reading. Verse number 6. And at this sound, when they heard the sound of all the speaking in other tongues, languages, I'm sure the sound of the rushing mighty wind and all that commotion, as they heard the sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Verse 7, amazed and astonished, they ask, are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? But others sneered and said, they are filled with new wine. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. So we're going to talk about today why we need this fuel. Make sure you get your fuel. We're talking about filling up for this journey ahead. Bow your heads with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our hearts so we will not sin against you. And please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. Now, I love the scripture, Joel chapter number 2, where it says that in the last day, God will pour out God's spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall dream dreams. Your old men shall see visions. Even on the handmaidens and the servants, the scripture says, God will pour out his spirit, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is the promise that God gave to the people who were immediately following this kind of magnificent and once in a lifetime experience of seeing someone, remember, dead on Friday and walking around on Sunday. This is indeed one of the great, powerful contributions I want to believe we have as a church, as followers of Jesus, people who are gathering not just because we don't have anything else better to do, but we do believe that this same spirit that God has offered, has proclaimed he would pour out on everyone. This same spirit is active and available even among us. Now, I gotta, you know, take a few moments to talk about why this distinction is so important. Because there is, I saw as I was traveling, a growing phenomenon of folks who are starting to gather to meet, and even some folks who are already meeting under the guise of church, but they call themselves atheists. There is a growing number of atheist or agnostic churches. places where people are gathering and in many respects, understanding and appreciating the importance of gathering and being in community, but are leaving behind that element or that foundational truth of God and God's revelation to the world. This idea that we can have an atheist church, a gathering of people who do not believe in God, but want to still call themselves the church, is a very fascinating and troubling development all at the same time. Because I want to believe that there is indeed something about the world in which we live that is contributing to the radical isolation of the individual. That people are searching for meaning, and people are searching for hope, and people are searching for community. People are understanding that as the world gets more technologically advanced and invested in overdetermined scientific ideas that I believe are not fully able to give an account of who we are. Why? Because I do believe that there's some things that only can be answered by the idea and the reality of God. That's how many know there's some things that happen in your life you can't test it in a test tube. I don't know. Y'all, there's some decisions that you make that you knew wasn't a decision that was the smartest thing out there. All the evidence was leading you to go one way. But somehow you still ended up in a mess. Somebody say amen. There are some things and some questions and some challenges that are going on in our lives that are not able to be answered just by our reason alone. And yet we know that there also is a deep challenge that all of us are struggling to really come to grips with about this individualized society that is springing up all around us. Dare I say that has already showed up. This idea that you can have a church that does not fully embrace or believe in the God, the creator of the universe, and extract or have the same kind of impact or benefit, I want to tell you today, that is not the kind of church the way church is. Now, let's be clear. We are a church that certainly is non-denominational in the sense that we have all kinds of folk who come from many kinds of backgrounds. I know over the 11 years, we've had Muslims and we've had Buddhists and we've had atheists and agnostics. We've had Catholic Christians and Quaker Christians and Baptist Christians and Pentecostal Christians and nominal Christians, amen. We've had on fire Christians. We've had the heal the sick and raise the dead Christians. And we've had the sleep all the way through church Christians, amen. We've had all kind of Christians that have made their way through this church. But let me be clear that we are a church who believes in the power of the Holy Spirit. We are a church who embraces the fact that everyone in this building has a spiritual gift that can only be unlocked by your connection to God. You may have some talents that you don't think are a result of God's grace in your life, and that's why so many people can just go on and do all kind of things and be totally unaware that it is the gifting of God at work in their life. But I want you to know that we are a church that believes that God is at work with his hand on your life. We are a church that takes seriously the biblical witness of the gospel writers who declares that there is one who is coming that will baptize you with the Holy Ghost. We are a church who is open to the movement of God in our lives. We believe that it's all right to speak in other tongues, and we believe it's all right to prophesy. We believe it's all right to seek healing for your body and your mind and your soul. We believe it's all right to manifest the fruit of the Spirit. love, joy, peace, goodness, meekness, temperance, mercy. All these fruit that should be a result of you being fueled by the Spirit. And I'm convinced that this world that is dominated by the forces of evil and spiritual wickedness in high places can only be overcome by a church that is fueled by the Spirit. Make no mistake about it, brothers and sisters. You need the fuel of the Holy Spirit in your life. And how many of you know sometimes, you know, in your real life car situation, if you put the wrong kind of stuff in your car, you're going to feel the effect. So that's going to lead to my first point, brothers and sisters, that not all fuel is equal. Hello, somebody. Somebody say, not all fuel is equal. What does that mean? It means, my brothers and sisters, just like if you put Chevron fuel in your car, Shell fuel in your car. I don't know, if you like me and you can't always afford that, you kind of go down to the Arco fuel. Hello, somebody. Beacon fuel. And then when times are even a little tougher, you just go down to the no-name fuel. Do I have a witness in here today? But how many of you know that all that fuel ain't equal? Hello, somebody. You put some of that fuel in your car and your car will start kind of okay. But you'll have a sputter here and there. Do I have a witness in here today? How many of you know in this world you will be tempted and presented with many kind of options to fuel your spirit? But the fuel we're talking about, verse number 4, it says in this text that all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. Why must you be filled with the Holy Spirit? Well, I think the first thing you just need to keep appreciating is that the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God. And this Spirit of God will make your life filled with the power necessary for godliness and for your everyday living. If you make, my brothers and sisters, some choices around what will fuel you, and you are depending on things that are not of God to fuel you, I want to submit, it's like you putting that no-name gas in the most important part of your soul. And why would you settle for some no-name gas when you have access? Lord, have mercy. To the fuel that comes from heaven. Now, I'm gonna mess up a few of y'all because, you know, even if you look at the price differentials on the no-name gas versus the name brand gas, you ain't saving nothing but a few dollars. And my question to all of us is our soul worth more than a few dollars of compromising, of settling? You see, I believe that when you don't have the right fuel in your system, you will not be positioned in the world with the ability to be formed in a way that resists the evils of this day. Tell your neighbor, you got to get in the right formation. You got to get in the right formation. And I'm not talking about Beyonce's song. Although, you know, she got a couple good points there. Just tell your neighbor, get information, amen, get information. And, you know, you can just figure out what I'm talking about later. But when you don't have the right fuel forming your heart, listen, I believe it begins to manifest itself in the ways in which we are susceptible to the mimic and the fake manifestations of Christian faith in the world. One of my greatest theological inquiries is how we as Christians, followers of Jesus, be so caught up in the ways of death in the world, particularly our country. I believe it's because we are not in the right formation process. We're settling for some no-name fuel. When you and I have access to the Spirit of God that is given to all who would ask. As a matter of fact, if you take seriously the scripture I read earlier in the book of Joel, it says that God in the last day will pour it out on everyone. Which what? Means that it's not just about you having to ask for it. God said he'll pour it out even without you asking. But some of us, as soon as it starts to pour, we get our umbrellas. Hello, somebody. And we try to make sure that that don't get on me. But don't you know only here in America are people resisting the outpouring of the Spirit of God? All over the world, the fastest growing social movements, as anthropologists talk about, is hip-hop, Islam, and Pentecostal Christian faith. That in other countries, folk are putting their umbrellas down. They're saying, I need to get in on this fuel from heaven. Could it be, my brothers and sisters, that some of our challenge here in Western Christian faith is that we are too tied to the fake fuel? And it's manifesting itself in all kinds of ways. How can we who claim to follow the Prince of Peace be so committed to owning a peace? How is it that we who say he came to set the captive free be so invested in keeping other people in captivity? How is it that for many Christians, violence that leads to death is such an easy road to travel without any of us calling into question our own soul regeneration? Points to deep theological deficiency in Western Christian formation that you and I are not really fueled by God's Spirit to the point where we can trust God no matter what happens. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Though you take all my money, you take all of my belongings, God, I'm still gonna trust you like Job. We put so much faith in the fake fuel of this world to sustain us that we have forsaken the fuel of the Holy Spirit. And I want to tell you today, when you buy into the no-name fake fuel, it'll manifest itself. It'll manifest itself by some of us chasing after these political figures and signing up for all kind of crazy political projects. I was in Louisville speaking. What day was that? Let me see. Today's Sunday. I think it was Friday. I can't remember. I was coming back from Palestine and I stopped over to speak, and Donald Trump happened to be in town. Speaking at the NRA convention while I was speaking across the street at a Festivals of Faith interfaith meeting, and they asked me to come and talk about how do I make peace? How do we make peace as followers of Jesus? So when I found out Brother Trump was across the street, I felt like I need to go meet Brother Trump, praise the Lord, and all the NRA people, because many of these folk claim to follow Jesus. And it raised all kinds of things about the theological deficiency of American Christian faith that makes us more susceptible to authoritarian, patriarchal, and fascist type leaders that are all too willing to oppress the poor and leave their own power intact. If you and I don't get the fuel from heaven, we will find ourselves susceptible to those kinds of expressions of evil in the world. Why? Because the fuel we have can't resist it. If your formation is weak, you will be seduced. If your formation is strong, we will overcome. So our formation will determine our ability to resist or comply with these fuels that are out there in the world. How do you get yourself built up in a way where you can have the kind of powerful fuel? You need to do practices like prayer. In the scripture, it says they were all together in one place, which means you have to be unified with some folk. Hopefully it's our church. You can live in community, not just with the two or three folk you like. Because how many of you know the two or three folk you like ain't gonna push you like the whole body can push you? You need to be in study. You can't be fueled with the power of God's Spirit and never study the Word of God. How can you be fueled by God's Spirit and you know more lyrics to JV and Weezy and Beyonce than you know about the eternal Word of God? Don't tell me you, oh, my pastor, my memory just won't let me memorize these scriptures. We was over there in Palestine. They started playing Tupac. Dun, 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 and everybody just turned up. Palestinians, Jews, everybody. Americans, everybody. I said, my goodness. Even in other languages, this hip-hop thing is just... Your mind can pick up whatever you train your mind to hold on to. You get fueled by engaging in fellowship and service and justice. We don't just do justice because we have this altruistic hope for humankind. We do justice because justice is formation. When you do justice, it helps your heart to become less wicked. I wish I could talk to somebody in here today. You know you got a wicked heart. Don't you got a wicked heart? Let somebody cut you off on the freeway. See how wicked you can get that fast. Let somebody not pay you your $10 back. Let somebody talk about you at the family reunion. Let somebody stand in front of you while you're trying to watch your game. Tell your neighbor, wicked. But when you do justice and mercy, God starts to refashion your heart according to the ways of God. I hope y'all understand that the reason the Way Church does justice and mercy and prayer and fasting and fellowship is because God is working on us. God's turning me into a better man. God's turning you into a better woman. God's turning us into a better people. So we can be fueled with the Spirit of God. Give your neighbor a quick high five and tell him, are you fueled by the Spirit? So the question you have to ask yourself, are you fueled by the spirit that comes from God? Hello, somebody. Is there enough prayer, unity, power available so you are filled up for the journey and assignment ahead for us to be the church? And understand, you need the fuel because we are called to be the church. You don't need no fuel if you're not trying to do the kingdom work of God. You can depend on your own strength. But when you're trying to break down the wickedness of the kingdom of the enemy, you're going to need some fuel. When you're trying to resist the onslaught of the enemy in your family, you're going to need some fuel. When you're trying to stay focused and not yield to temptation, you're going to need some fuel. And you better make sure you're engaging in prayer, in unity and power, so you can have access to the fuel. Oh, somebody shout hallelujah. The second thing you need to understand why you need this fuel, it will give you better mileage. Somebody holler, better mileage. What am I talking about? Well, come on, go back to your car. How many of you notice sometimes when your car is, you know, not as new, you get less mileage per gallon? If you're not getting maximum efficiency, how many of you know you won't get as far as you would if you had optimal performance? I love this particular point because you had 120 folk in a room. They weren't trying to talk to nobody else. Half of them were still scared about Jesus being crucified. Remember, because that's what they did after Jesus was crucified. Jesus told them, go and tell everybody, okay, where's the room? I need to go. Lock themselves up in a room. So for them, they was like, cool, upper room? That's even better, because that means nobody can get up there. Locked up in a room, but God, through the outpouring of God's spirit, caused what was happening in that room to go far beyond the limitations of those walls. Whew, Jesus says in their own languages, people outside the room heard about God's deeds and power in a way they could understand. When you have the fuel of God in your life, listen, everything you are doing will have further reach. How many of you have some parts of your life that you wish could have greater influence, greater impact? And you're trying to figure out, how come it seems like my heart's desire can only resonate with a few folk, can only go so far, or even in my own vocation, I'm always sputtering along. I know I used to be a little bit better. I know we as a church used to have a little bit better of a reach and an impact. Now folk run away from the church. We can't reach across difference because we are overdetermined by these limiting, small-minded ideas, because we aren't tapped into the fuel of God. I want you to know, my brothers and sisters, that there is indeed an opportunity for you and I to have better mileage, better impact in our calling, if we can ever fill up with the fuel of God's spirit. Why? Because the fuel that will fuel us will help you reach into places that otherwise you could not have access to. Lord, I don't know how we have reached as far as we have reached in this region. We not no mega church. We don't have no mega budget. We don't have no mega numbers, but we have mega ministry. Why? Because I believe that our church is not built and grounded on the kinds of fuels of, as one of my friends says, numbers, nickels, and noise. But we're grounded in a fuel that says God can do a lot with a little. We got folk in here who believe that they can be moved into positions of political leadership. We have folk who believe they can teach at world-class universities. We have folk who believe they can spend their life caretaking for those who are under-resourced or dealing with the end of their life. We have folks who are teachers. We have folks who are mentors. We have parents. We have volunteers. And truth be told, a lot of us don't know how we're making it every day. But I want you to know it's because when you have the fuel of God, you get better mileage. And you better get connected to some folk who have access to this fuel. Don't you think that all the fuel is equal and you put that no-name stuff and you're going to get the kind of distance you need. God needs you. God needs me. God needs us to be fueled by this spirit. So when we hit the streets, when you in the boardroom, when you on the block, when you in the classroom, you can dismantle every kind of evil, every kind of sickness, every kind of disease, every kind of system. And you're not going to have no fuel for racism. And then a different fuel for capitalism, and a different fuel for patriarchy, and a different fuel for depression, and a different fuel for fighting, and a different fuel for homelessness. No, it's the same fuel that'll get you where you need to be, because it comes from the same source. You ought to give your neighbor one quick high five and tell him you better get that fuel for some better mileage. So how much mileage are you getting right now out of the fuel you have? It's the question you have to ask yourself. Is this fuel taking you as far as you need to go? Where do you need the spirit to expand your impact? How do you need to invite the spirit into your life? This spirit that God says he's pouring out on everybody. How do you invite that spirit into your life, into your family, into your marriage, into your vocation, your school, your career? How do you invite that spirit into your life so you can get better mileage, better performance, better optimal reach for your assignment? Last thing I'll say, not only must you appreciate that not all fuel is equal. Not only must you appreciate that you'll get better mileage, but listen, you must appreciate that you need a turbo boost. Now, my old car, my Passat, I've been riding it around for 20 years. Driven it across country 8 times. Car has been a faithful car. Towards the end of its life, more trips to the hospital. Trying to keep it functional. And the mechanic said, what you need to do when you go get your gas is there's this little bottle there, and it's called a turbo boost gas additive. When you fill up, spend the extra $3-4 and just put that turbo into your gas tank. It'll clean out. Lord, I'm about to help somebody. It will clean out all those things in your carburetor, in your gas line, in your engine, all the crud that's building up over years of use and misuse, because I see how tough you are on this car. You put that additive in there and that thing will help your car go a lot further than you just putting this little gas in here. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that in Christian theological faith and conversations, we do believe as the whole of the church that when you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you are given a seed of the Holy Spirit. Scripture says it is a down payment. Why? Because we still believe that Jesus is coming back. And when Jesus comes back, Jesus is going to kind of, you know, catch and resurrect and take up all that is in you for eternal living. So that seed of the Spirit is there. And we going to open up that up a little bit more for some of y'all. You're trying to figure out, but Pastor, I don't know what you're talking about. When you say yes to God, God puts God's self in you through His Spirit. That's what I'm talking about. And some of us ought to be afraid of that, because that means God is walking around with us wherever we go. You worried about the preacher? You know, I crack up, you know, because I don't really care about too much anything anymore. You know, feel like people just gonna do what they gonna do anyway. You know, so I just say, do you? Amen. Don't be worried about McBride. Amen. I'm trying to get to heaven myself. Praise the Lord. I don't have a whole lot of time to be trying to, you know, keep track of what you got going on. Amen. Folk put on some music. We was at an event and they put on some music and it was just so, you know, filled with all kind of language, and it was embarrassingly, oh, Pastor, I'm sorry. I said, listen, I like Pac. I'm not tripping off that. I mean, you ain't got to like worry about me. As if God, you know, I mean, like I don't have nothing to do with anything. Folk get around and they don't want to curse around you because it's going to feel like it's going to mess up something. Be like, if you curse when I'm not around, I mean, what, I don't have nothing to give you. So if you curse, but don't let me mess up your vibe. Thank you, Jesus. Folk will get all hung up on the preacher and not realize that inside of you, there's something even more sacred that you ought to be protecting. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't think God's hung up on your cussing and all that much either. But I do think God wants you to understand, listen, this is what the scripture says in 1 Corinthians. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Ooh, help me in here today. That means that the Spirit is inside of you, living and dwelling. So whatever you do with your body, you better know that the Holy Spirit is right along there with you. Whatever you do with your mind, the Spirit is right along there with you. And the great thing about the Spirit is there to convict, to restore, to empower, to heal. That's what the Spirit is there for. That's like you going and getting the right gas. And we still believe in our Pentecostal kind of spirituality within Christian faith. The Methodists called this a second work of grace. That God would want to do a little bit of extra stuff. Because how many of you know, some of us, if we keep it real, we like my worn out car out there. Hard living. Hello, somebody. I wish I could talk to somebody in here today. Difficult life. Some of it we brought on ourselves. Some of it the world threw on top of us. And God is saying, I want to put a little bit of extra turbo in your tank to clean out all that stuff. Lord, help me to preach this in here. To get rid of all that buildup that's keeping you from being the best that God has created you to be. God is saying, you want some more courage? Get some turbo inside of you. You want some more power? Put some turbo inside of you. And how do you have access to this turbo power of God? Well, again, I'm telling you, God says he's pouring it out on everybody. So you don't got to figure out how you get it. All you got to do is lift up your hands and say, God, fill me up until I can't take no more. God, I'm tired of living my life in such a way where I don't have what I need in order to do what you've called me to do. God, I want you to fill me up. Fill me up where, Lord God, my heart is broken. Fill me up, God, where my spirit, Lord God, is feeling like it's exhausted. Fill me up so I can do what you've called me to do. And I'm here to tell you, when you get to a place where God is able to fill you up with this turbo, then I believe you'll be well positioned to be able to have the fuel you need to do God's special assignment in your life. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him, get fueled up. Tell somebody else, get your turbo. Because when you get turboed and filled up with the power of God, then no weapon that's formed against you shall be able to prosper. I know the devil is out here looking and lurking for a way to cause you to feel like you got to throw in the towel. But I'm here to tell you today that victory belongs to the one who has the ability to get filled up with the power of the living God. I want you to know that God wants you to get everything he has for you. Don't settle for the no-name gas. When God wants to give you the best that he has for you, don't you settle for the half-filled up. When God wants to fill you up and overflow every part of your life, I'm here to tell you that this is the day. This is the hour. This is the moment. This is the opportunity for anybody who wants to be fueled by God. I'm tired of having what I don't need when I have access to everything that God has given to me. Tell your neighbor, I need the fuel. Tell somebody, I want the fuel. Tell your neighbor, the fuel is mine. And if God gives it to me, the devil can't take it away from me. If God fills me up, the devil can't defeat me. If God gives me what I need, my family will be what God said it would be. My business will become what God has ordained. Our church will be the church that reaches the people that nobody else can reach. We will see justice because we're fueled up. We will see mercy because we're fueled up. We will see the power of God manifest in the people of God because God gives us everything we need. Shout hallelujah, somebody. Fuel, fuel, fuel. The fuel that comes from heaven. Not the fuel that comes from the United States. Not the fuel that comes from your racial family progeny. Not the fuel that comes from your education. I want you to get and be proud of all that fuel. But you better make sure you get the fuel of God. Be open to this fuel. Let this fuel fill you up. Come on, stand with me.